or maybe a few years of analysis, but very briefly before getting on to what I really want to tell you, and with a new title, which is, if I ever publish this, will it be the new title, as you will see, and my concern for literature and literary criticism. I wondered what there was in this title, in these two figures, one hole, I mean, big round, and so straight away I said, okay, this is mother and father, father and mother. And of course, since we have analysis and literature, or literature analysis, I just shift them and try to find out where I stand in this business. That was the beginning of an explanation. Then I said, well, maybe there's something else. Maybe the fact that I put all this in two eggs, you know, this is the round. So I said, okay, this is mother and me. This is child and mother. I don't want them to be separated, so I put them in an egg. Okay, then I said, well, maybe we can go somewhere else. This is too general. This doesn't help. Everybody does that in his doodles. This won't lead us anywhere. So I went on and on. And then after a while, I discovered that maybe there was a secret desire in me, which is not essential, because maybe what I said before is more important, what I've said about mother and father and so on is more important. But there was at the moment, for these months or years, something important in me, which was to try to speak about hierarchy between literature and psychoanalysis. What's better, literature or psychoanalysis? This was, of course, stupid. This was completely stupid. And I will answer Derrida on that. Because, of course, literature is a material. And psychoanalysis is the tool to look into this material. So you can't put them in the same bag. You have to say we have two objects, or at least two entities. One thing which is a material produced by a subject, and then another thing which is a theory produced by Freud, Lacan, Winnicott, and us. And then, of course, they have something in common, of course, because what is common to the two of them is a structure. This is what I'm going to do. And this idea gave me, from then on, finding out that my drawing was silly, I asked myself what the question mark meant. And my question mark meant that what was I going to say to those people who say, oh, well, literature is much more important than psychoanalysis. The Greek myth have said it all. You don't need psychoanalysis, you don't need Freud, you have Shakespeare. Of course, this made me think a lot for a few years. And not Derrida. And I'm going to talk about the metaphor in a minute, and showing that this guy did not understand what a metaphor was. And of course, Freud did, and Lacan does, and we do. So I thought, maybe in my two formulas, I was figuring a fight between the bloody people who said literature first and psychoanalysis, and us who said psychoanalysis and literature, without making two enemies of this entity, because one is the material, the other one is... So the fact was between me and Derrida and people in Paris who say, oh, well, you don't need psychoanalysis. Literature is good enough to tell you the truth. And I came up with this idea, which is in Freud and which is everywhere, and which is commonplace. Yes, literature tells the truth, but we don't know what that is. And my dreams tell my truth, but I don't know what that is. And without Freud, I would not understand anything about my dreams. End of my introduction. And so now I come to my little drawing, which most of you know. I thought that because of the fight between the two schools that I am trying to describe, and my place in the fight, I mean, you know, as a contender against those who do not want a psychoanalytic approach to literature, was that there's one thing that I have to speak about for my colleagues here, which they know, but you will forgive me for repeating myself. It's the concept of representation. This is where Lacan comes in, because Lacan read Freud, and of course at the same time, although there was no connection between Saussure and Freud, they didn't know each other, they didn't meet, but they were both working on the same structure, which is, of course, signified and signifier, or object and representation. And this is what happens. Both in linguistics, simple linguistics, not difficult, and psychoanalysis, we have what I call the bar, that is to say the fact that humans are split, that humans are born and have lost their mother or their first object, and therefore are incomplete. And of course you have, thank God, libido, that is to say a force to dream, a force, Freud said drive, you know, something that pushes libido, la pression du désir, which is not yet desire. So this is the first figure. We are not yet in linguistics here, we are in psychology. Then we have the bar and the desire to go over the bar. And so we have here in linguistics and psychoanalysis, we have what we, the subject does what? The subject which is, who is incomplete does what? The subject looks at a referent, that is to say an object, and finds a sign to represent it. And this is representation. And this representation is the final, the prime structure which enables me to say that there is, and Lacan, a great deal in common between Saussurean linguistics and Freud psychology. Okay, so you know this because I do it every year, so I won't bore you with it, but you understand that we are incomplete, we want the one, which is impossible, this is why I put, this is the unconscious, but we pretend, we try to, and what we must understand is that what we signify is not reality, but something symbolic. Language is a representation. My dreams are a representation. So what Freud did, which was a fundamental discovery, was that there's one area where humans represent, and that's a dream. And until Freud, people could interpret the dream, but without any rule, without any theory behind it. And Freud said, you know the German quotation, which I won't tell you because of my German accent, but he discovered, that's the beginning of the Traum Deutung, that the dream could be interpreted, that the dream was not meaningless. You know this, so this is quite simple. So we have this drawing, I put it in the corner here, the little drawing, libido, then desire to go over. And of course, we must always remember that the going over is not a real, in the Lacanian sense of real, is not a real going over. It's a going over in imagination. We hallucinate. Literature is hallucination. The dream is hallucination. So we come to this idea that the dream and literature have the same structure, the same fundamental structure, very plain. And of course, you could then write this because, okay, I go over the bar. I don't really go over the bar, but I think I do, and that suffices me, because you cannot go over the bar unless you're dead. But what happens is that you produce something. What do you, can you see, or can you all see the drawing, more or less? You produce something which is what? Which is parole, discourse, speech, symbolical actions, symbolical behavior, and literature. And what is this literature made of? It's made of something which you could, this is the object, the lovely object, the wonderful object, my mother's body, me, the belly of my mother, me with a good relationship with my father, whatever you like, me happy in love, whatever you like, the perfect object, which is impossible, of course. But then, because you cannot reach here, you go there and you select a little O, which is very similar to Lacan, little A, even though it's more complex in Lacan. So we find what? We find a signifier. We find a representation of our metaphysical original desire of totality, which we cannot be total, cannot be God. I wish I were, but it's not that. I've been trying, but it doesn't work. So, shall we go from big O, which is impossible, to little o, which is a representation, and this is, of course, what? The structure of the metaphor. Because what is the metaphor? Something that you do not say, something that's absent, but which you represent. So you see, the metaphor is what you represent, but the metaphor doesn't speak. Derrida is completely wrong there. The metaphor, he says, oh, rose is a rose, you don't need an explanation. Of course, but what is behind the production of a rose is a rose is a rose? You see, so that in the end, you don't want to stay with the manifest. You have to go into the latent. And the latent, what is manifest, what is latent? You all know this. Freud, beautifully looking at the dream, said, well, the dream has two levels. The dream is, of course, a manifest level with a story, coherent or incoherent, lots of images. Anyway, the dream is what happens while you are asleep. So this is unconscious. Then what you get is the narrative of the dream, which is not yet a dream, and sometimes only bits, but it tells you what your dream may have been. And then you get the analysis of this narrative, but the narrative of the dream, and this is essential to literary people who do not want psychoanalysis, the narrative of the dream is not the dream. You see, and the analysis of the dream is not the narrative itself. The narrative of the dream has to be analyzed, has to be bloody well analyzed. And this is difficult, of course, but it's a different enterprise. I dream, I am the dreamer, I read, I am the reader, I am in my imagination, I am the hero of Greek tragedy or whatever, or of Shakespeare, fine. This is something, this is one part of my life. The other part is the analysis of what I do, the symbolical dimension of what I do. And so we want to tell literary people who do not want psychoanalysis that the dream is not the manifest, but what's behind. And why is this more important than that? Because it is this area which produces that. You see, and this is desire. And of course, what does desire do? Desire selects signifiers. Desire builds your dreams with things that it picks up, or he or she picks up in your recent life, whatever. And when you read, you do the same thing. When you read, when I read, I reconstruct the text. That's why there are so many critics, because each of us, a critic who is not a psychoanalyst, that is to say, who has no scientific approach to literature, because we have a scientific approach to literature. A critic who has no scientific approach to literature, no theory behind, he just rewrites his own story. He paraphrases, sometimes very brilliantly, sometimes beautiful, but this is not scientific, this is just literature. He produces poetry, but this is not going to help us to know who we are and how we organize our lives. What we have to take is go into the other room or go on the couch and say, okay, I read and this is what I saw. But what is the meaning of this? And this is another enterprise. And this is the psychoanalytical enterprise. Okay, so we are here. We have a desire, unconscious desire. Very general, of course. I could be more subtle, but because you know all this, but let's get on to the end. Maybe this will be clearer. And I produce a discourse in literature, in my behavior, in my love, in my hatreds, and in my dreams. Okay, but the engineer, the architect of the dream or of literature is not there, but there. That is to say, the architect of literature is not the, do you know this, of course, the conscious decision, I'm going to write a novel on the working class. I'm going to work, write a novel on the end of liberalism. I'm going to work on a class on fascism. Okay, well, that's you can do that. I mean, that's conscious. I'm not saying it's without value. I'm saying it's part of the enterprise. But if I say I'm going to write on the working classes, the real reason is my unconscious desire. And it's not a reason that I know unless I analyze it. So that in the end, the classical critic, who can be very good, very intelligent, he's going to stay here. He's going to stay on this level. He's going to be Zola, he's going to be Dickens, he's going to be Shakespeare. Again, to Shakespeare, I have an exception because he's so brilliant that maybe he analyzes what he writes in a way. But I'm going to be Balzac or Proust. You see, but the analysis is restricted to the surface of the dream. Literature is nothing, structurally of course, is nothing else than the narrative of the dream. Structurally, not of course, because of the detail. So if we want to be real scientists, if we want to build in a science the text, then we have to go and look at what Freud did. And here we get to this drawing. So I didn't say enough about the metaphor, but I hope you understand. This is what I write. But this is what is meant, is implied. You see, in the metaphor, the essential is always absent. If I say a woman is a rose, okay, it's a woman, or if I write a vase, as Lacan did when he spoke about, you know, his drawing in flowers, the essential is the vase is the woman, of course, but the word woman is not pronounced. In the metaphor, what is represented is not there. And that's why we need an image to represent it, with, of course, a diversion, because we never get to there. We only get to there. Okay, so now what we have, so what we are telling here is that, something that let me stop for a minute and say something which I think I want to say anyway, I don't know why. Freud discovered manifest and discovered latent. But then people say, well, if it's unconscious, how can you speak about it? It's not conscious, you cannot speak. And this is where Freud, great genius Freud, said, oh yes, but the bar is porous. I do not know what is in the unconscious, but it manifests itself. There are signs, and this is language, there are signs, there are symbols, and this can be analyzed. So if you think of the bar as something which is impassable, but porous, and if you concentrate on what has gone through the bar, that's to say what is symbolical, then you become, you are an analyst. Okay, so this is the drawing that I like best for today, which you have inspired me, my dear friends. So, the drive, I want to go on the other side. I want to be king, I want to be Hamlet, I want to be not Hamlet because he dies in the end, but I want to be a hero and so on. So, what do? I produce something. This something is my going from O, which is impossible, to little O, which is a representation of my desire. And of course, I think I have said enough about representation, except that this is fundamental. Literature is here. Literature is in the trajectory between my unconscious desire to be a good son, a good father, a good lover, a good friend, or perfect, and then what I actually am. The trajectory is the selection of a signifier for this desire. So that in the end, what we come back with a dream, which is the structure of literature. We have desire, and in the selection of signifiers for my desire, this is Lacan, for my desire, in the selection of my signifiers, I reveal myself as I don't know who I am, and then this has to be analyzed. And of course, the act of choosing representative of my desire, of choosing signifiers, or this trajectory that I have here illustrated with this arrow is my unconscious desire and is the secret of my jouissance. If I do it like Wade because it pleases me, except that, and this is our tragedy, sometimes it pleases me because it hurts. And this is mechanism. That is to say, jouissance in Lacan is not pleasure. It's a pleasure to do something which may be constructive, good for you, or destructive, not so good for you. What is analysis? The discovery of what is destructive in you. Why bloody well do I do this? And of course, in the end, you stop. Maybe if your analysis succeeds, you stop doing it and everything is fine. You can't go wrong. You're never late at meetings and you never exceed your time. I have another 5 minutes.
No, and so on.
So that's fine. My analysis is finished.
You don't.
I am on time. Lovely. It took me so many years that, I mean, you know. Well, so here we are. Now let me come back and conclude. I've said just a little word about jouissance, but you understand. I just want to say something again, in a footnote. We have had a beautiful talk, difficult, on Lacan. What you must understand is that the 26 years of the seminary were Lacan's post-analysis. Exactly as mine, speaking to you in my post-analysis. He was a psychiatrist, he knew a lot, but if you take some of the concepts in the Lacan of 50, 56, 57, 58, and those in 75, the same word, the same signifier, but other, but it's not the same signified. I mean, through the years, and this is why Lacan takes so many years, because it takes you, you can't do more than 2 seminars a year, if you read it, maybe one. So it takes you 10 years to, he said seven, 10 years to read the whole. And the best Lacan, the Lacan of the end, the one who understood a lot, and therefore who altered the meaning of some of the signifiers that he used at the beginning. The other is, changes, other is one word that changes meaning throughout the years. So you want to be careful when you work on Lacan. If you pick him in 55, you're going to say things which were true to 55, but which do not verify 10 years later. So this is very well what I wanted to say this about it. Okay, I'm almost finished, that's fine. So, jouissance, you understand. That's my desire, into action. But my desire can be destructive. And the aim of my analysis is to find out how can I destroy myself. And this is, of course, my relationship to my mother, to my father, to my sisters, my grandmother, my place in the genealogy, and so on. So this takes a lot of work. This is how it works. And it's quite simple, in fact. And then, this could be my last word. I have another drawing which I have done every year for many years, so I don't want to bore you, and I'll stop here. But I have to finish with this. I'm sure you're, this is in, Norman Holland uses this, and I think Freud somewhere uses it. I use it a lot. We have the bar. We have the porosity of the bar. We have libido. I cannot get you, oh, it's impossible. I mean, I cannot be whole, I cannot be a man and a woman. I cannot be God, so it's impossible. So I am barred. Therefore, I am an incomplete subject, a subject with a stroke. So what do? And this is language and psychoanalysis. I turn around, and this is, and I come here with the discovery I mentioned and didn't explain, Freud's idea of substitute, ersatz. Freud said desire is represented thanks to an ersatz. Freud, the desire, unconscious desire, is represented by something which is not it, but which represents it perfectly. And analysis, what is analysis? Analysis is the study of my trajectory. How did I do? The going back, how did I, why did I choose this as a representative? You see, so this would be a little o. Why is my little o like this? Why did I choose this representative of that desire? And this you can illustrate like this. This would be the manifest of the dream. The rest would be latent, okay? That is to say, the architect, the producer, of the dream. This is the narrative of the dream, all the literary work. And this is my last word. I have spoken of representation. I have spoken of jouissance a bit, not enough, but a bit. And of course, I must not end. I feel like ending by, I don't know if it's a concept, but it's a good notion, day's residue. Freud said, we build our dreams with day's residue. And I would say, we write our literature with day's residue. Of course, it's much nobler, it can be a nicer battle, but it's not so trivial as day's residue. But we write with what we consciously know and what we consciously see. We write like a documentary, like Dickens or Balzac. So this is not to be despised. I mean, the study of the narrative of the dream can be studied in itself, but it's far from constituting the essential literature. If, and this is what critics who do not do literature do, they stick with the day's residue. They only analyze the surface, you see. It's silly to speak of the surface and of the depth, but you understand what I mean, of course. And many very beautiful critics, lovely critics, they have good style, they like, but they paraphrase this. They never tell us why and which desire has constructed this, and therefore they miss, if not, there is more than half of what makes literature function. Thank you.